It's another beautiful day in American suburbia. The sun is shining and residents go about their regular, ordered, everyday lives, mowing their lawns, taking their children to school, and greeting each other with a friendly wave. But beneath this blissful, utopian veneer lies something else, something hidden just beneath the surface, something dark, violent, and dangerous. Join me as we continue exploring the mind and body, as we take a peek behind the white picket fences at David Lynch's Blue Velvet.
It's a strange world, isn't it?
Welcome back to the Evolution of Horror. My name is Mike, and as ever, I am your host. If you're tuning in for the first time, then welcome. In this podcast, we explore and dissect the history and the evolution of the horror genre by looking at particular subgenres one series at a time. We are currently in the middle of exploring the mind and body in horror cinema, and this is part 11, in which, as that intro suggested, we're talking about one of the greatest movies ever made. That is David Lynch's Blue Velvet. This will, of course, be a very spoilerific discussion. And if there's anyone out there who hasn't seen Blue Velvet, I would urge all of you to go away and give it a watch. It's a really wonderful film. Go and watch it. You will not regret it. Okay, let's get straight into it. We've got lots to cover this week, and I'm very excited to welcome back this week's guest, because she hasn't been on the podcast since our Ghost series discussing Poltergeist with me. And to be fair, she's been very busy. She's been directing her first ever feature horror film, Censor, which I cannot wait to hear all about. It is my great pleasure to welcome back to the podcast diehard Lynch fan and filmmaker Prano Bailey-Bond. Hello, Prano.
Hello, thanks for having me back.
Oh, thank you so much. For being here. How's lockdown life for you so far?
Yeah, it's all fine. I was just saying it's a time to kind of count your blessings, I suppose, and realize, you know, the little things that you do have, like appreciating your garden and, yes, you know, that kind of thing. So no, it's been fine. It's good to have a bit of a rest. I think I'm getting ready for life to start again now, though, and I've been watching lots of films, so that's good.
Oh, it's been a perfect excuse to just be an introvert and a film nerd, actually, hasn't it? It really has.
Totally. I think it's, somebody said right at the beginning of lockdown, it's when you find out if you're an introvert or an extrovert, and that's if your energy comes from, you know, socializing with people or from squirreling away. And I always thought I was an extrovert, but actually I think my energy definitely comes from lying on the sofa and watching like four films in a row.
Definitely, 100%, me too. So last time we spoke on here, you were talking about how you were kind of in the early writing stages of your sort of first feature film. Tell me about that now. How's that been going? That's been going well by the sounds of it.
Yeah, so we've shot it. Obviously right now things are in like a sort of semi-limbo period just because we're unable to continue working on it at the moment. But we're in sort of late stage post. We just need to do a tiny bit more filming, just like a couple of days. So we're waiting to be able to do that. But yeah, so we shot the film in October last year, and it was great. Had a lovely cast. We shot up in Leeds. So I've kind of at the point now where I've had a rest from the exhaustion of the shoot. So I'm like, you know, looking back on it really fondly.
Amazing. I'm so excited to see it. So what can you tell us about the film?
So it's a psychological horror thriller set during the early 80s against the backdrop of the social hysteria surrounding video nasties. And it's called Censor, and it follows a female film censor who's working during that period, whose world sort of blurs reality and fiction together as the film progresses.
Very cool. That's so exciting. And I guess quite lucky in a way that
principal sort of photography and filming at least was out the way, right, when lockdown started. So I suppose at least being at sort of post is an easier place to be, I imagine, like in this situation.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I know of people who were in the middle of their shoot, and I just think that must be so hard, because what you could do before lockdown happened and potentially what people might be able to do after lockdown might shift. So does that affect your story? And, you know, I think we were, you know, I can, again, something to be grateful for. I think I'm trying to focus on the things I can be grateful for at the moment. And definitely where we're at with the film is one of those things. But yeah, we've got a couple of days, just small things to pick up. So that's kind of interesting too, because it's such a small shoot, but it's just adapting to how filming might be for a little while after this period.
Yeah, I bet. So tell me, we're going to talk about Blue Velvet and all things David Lynch. Is David Lynch an influence on your work in any way, would you say?
Yes, definitely. Yeah, I grew up watching Twin Peaks as a kid. So my brother and sister sort of 10 and 8 years older than me. So I, as a child, wanted to like watch and do everything they were doing, because they were so grown up and cool. And so they watched Twin Peaks and I wanted to watch Twin Peaks, and it became my treat to stay up late on, I think it was a Saturday night, and watch Twin Peaks. And I had a t-shirt that I used to wear to school that said, "I killed Laura Palmer."
Amazing.
That none of the other kids understood who Laura Palmer was, and they'd be like, "Why have you got a t-shirt that says he killed this random person?" But yeah, in terms of my work, like Lynch is, he's always been a huge inspiration to me, I think, because he does things differently and his films are just so, you kind of feel them in a different way. They go deeper, for me anyway, for me, they kind of go somewhere deep and dark. But at the same time, they're so beautiful and really intelligent, and you can pick them apart for years.
For years, absolutely.
Keep discovering more and more. So
that's what I love about them too. We're sort of working our way through most of his filmography in this sort of run of episodes. We've already done Eraserhead, and obviously this one is kind of next. But something that I kind of have been asking everyone: how would you describe David Lynch's films? You know, what is a Lynchian film in your opinion?
I think we kind of approach a Lynchian film as an audience. I kind of approach it expecting to have my mind sort of blasted into like the stratosphere, like pulled apart into tiny pieces and then like put back together a bit wrong.
Yeah, nice.
So I think there's an element of that, but again, also there's like such beauty.
Yeah, I agree. It's really difficult to nail his films into a genre as well, in a way, because it's kind of tonally, they have a bit of everything. Like you said, they're beautiful. They're also absolutely terrifying at times. Sometimes they're hilariously broad and funny as well. Like, look at Twin Peaks. It's like, what is that? It's such a weird mix of so many different things, right?
Yeah. I mean, I watched accidentally, actually, the deleted scenes from Twin Peaks Fire Walk With Me. Mm. I watched it thinking it was Fire Walk With Me. It was labelled Fire Walk With Me. And me and my DOP, we were sitting there and we were like, I don't remember any of this. This is so different how I remember Twin Peaks. And then later realised it was the deleted scenes. And it was really interesting, particularly seeing that, like, on its own, isolated, these, because it was like a bad soap opera in so many ways. But then you kind of, when he puts it together, it becomes this weird, dreamy, magical kind of world. And I mean, so much of that, I think, is the sound. Yes. You know, he uses sound in such an incredible way.
100%. Do you have a favourite Lynch film?
Blue Velvet. It's actually my favourite film, probably one of my favourite films of all time.
Yeah, me too, 100%. I think it's the film that almost changed my life, you know? It kind of opened my eyes to some of the weirdness and boldness and just all of the things you can do with cinema. I'm so excited to discuss it. Let's do it, Prano. Let's talk about David Lynch's Blue Velvet.
From the mind of David Lynch comes a modern-day masterpiece, so startling, so provocative, so mysterious that it will open your eyes to a world you have never seen before.
And I still can see blue velvet.
Hey, neighbor. Here I come. You got about 1 second to live, buddy.
Through my teeth.
So Blue Velvet is about Jeffrey, whose father has a heart attack at the beginning of the film, and he returns back to his hometown to kind of look after his family while his dad's in hospital. And upon visiting his father in hospital, he discovers an ear, a severed ear in a field, which he takes to a local police department. And this ear is kind of the doorway, in a way, to the underbelly of Lumberton, where Jeffrey lives. And through this ear, he explores the dark side of Lumberton and the dark side of himself.
Oh, beautifully put. Lovely. So this is pretty much your favourite film of all time. Why? What is it that you love about this film so much?
It's changed over the years, and it's interesting because... it's almost, I don't want to set myself up as an expert on this film, because there's probably people who know so much more and can talk really intelligently about it. But I mean, I've loved it since I was younger, and my relationship with it, even though at times I've worried it might dampen, in fact, has just evolved and changed, I think. So when I was a teenager, I was really attracted to the way it used light and dark and how that was represented through Sandy, who is played by Laura Dern, and she's this kind of airy girl who's like the girl next door, basically, and she's dreamy. And I loved Sandy. I love the way she's introduced in the film. Like, I think she says in an interview that David Lynch wanted her to be the wind as she entered that frame. And you see it, like, it's this really abstract, weird, dark frame, and then there's this swell of music, and it's so romantic and melodramatic, and then Sandy steps out of the shadows.
Are you the one that found the ear?
It's just gorgeous. And I loved Sandy, and I also loved Dorothy and the sadness of Dorothy and this kind of femme fatale, but she's kind of beautiful and ugly all at the same time, because she lets the ugliness be part of the character and part of the sadness and part of the story. And so I think that was, you know, the beginning. It was very much, I was really attracted to those characters as like a teenage girl. And then when I was studying, I wanted to write my dissertation about Blue Velvet, or partly about Blue Velvet, and I was really worried that I might ruin it by watching it too much. But actually, it just made me love the film more. I discovered more and more about it, you know, reading critics' work, talking about the film. I think it's about repression. And that's something that really, really interests me as a subject, and something that I like to explore in my own work as well. Mm. It's about the things that we don't want to face in ourselves, we don't think are palatable in society and in ourselves, and yet the appeal of those things at the same time. Like, Jeffrey kind of embodies that. He's this kind of perfect, squeaky clean guy who lives in this hunky-dory town, and yet he wants to find out about this like dark criminal world. And I think as people who like to watch horror films, there's something of that in us as well.
Absolutely,
you know?
Yeah.
So it kind of makes me think about, you know, the appeal of horror the appeal of a darkness, and what that is, and why are we interested in crime and violence and all these dark things.
Agreed. I think what I love that it's kind of almost feels like two films, I guess, like what you mentioned. You've got Sandy, who almost represents this like 50s teen kind of cheesy, like almost Happy Days-esque kind of world, with diners and high schools and cars and jocks and stuff. And then it's almost like, yeah, it's like Jeffrey decides to explore this other genre going on in his town and kind of steps into this horror world instead. And it kind of seamlessly blends all those things together, which I love. You know, all of his films, I think, going forward, kind of, it feel like explore these themes a little bit. I mean, I know that Eraserhead is his first film, but it feels to me, if I was introducing somebody to Lynch, I would say start with Blue Velvet. It feels like, yeah, in some ways, the most accessible, and it feels like it kind of introduces all of the themes that David Lynch then goes on to sort of explore, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And it, you watch it and you think, why do people, you know, there was obviously the straight story was him coming along and saying, I can tell a straight story, but actually, yeah, Blue Velvet is a very traditional
completely
narrative structure. Yeah. It's really, really cleverly set up. And I recently watched the deleted scenes from Blue Velvet, which was amazing to watch, particularly as a filmmaker, having just made my, you know, being in post-production on my first feature and looking at, okay, what did he write and what did he cut out of that film? And you can see from watching that how much the edit process refined the story, you know, and clearly how much the editor would have sort of had a hand in that part of the storytelling, because there's scenes where we see Jeffrey, like, early on, before he's gone home to Lumberton, back in his university town, and he's spying on people having sex at a party.
Oh, no way. I didn't know that.
So this, yeah, so there's this like voyeur idea set up around him right from the beginning. And I actually really love that they didn't do that in the film, you know, that it was refined so much. But I don't know. It's just really, really interesting to look at how something's crafted like that and to look at the decisions that Lynch made. And it is a very traditional narrative and really, really brilliantly told.
Yeah, I agree. It's really interesting, isn't it? It's a really accessible story in some ways. I guess it goes to some very weird and dark places, but actually it kind of lures you in a very conventional Hollywood way, in a way.
Yeah.
And I love that David Lynch is quite... I think that maybe some people think that his films have this air of sort of pretentiousness about them. Like, you need to be, I don't know, academic or a real hardcore cinephile in order to like them. But actually, I think you can listen to David Lynch chat about his films, and I don't think he's that sort of person at all. And I think, if anything, he really hates these kind of like academic, you know, theories about his films and all of that. I think, you know, it's just supposed to kind of wash over you as a sort of sensory experience more than anything, yeah, isn't it? I think.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that iconic opening scene. Probably one of my favourite openings in cinema history. We have that camera panning down to a white picket fence. We hear the Blue Velvet music. We see bright red roses, sunflowers. We see kids crossing the road, a lollipop lady, people mowing their lawns, waving to each other. This kind of perfect suburban American existence. And then slowly things start getting stranger and darker. A man has a heart attack. This dog is barking. The camera glides down and we see beneath the grass these black bugs kind of eating each other. And everything goes dark and distorted and filled with dread. It's just, I think it's one of the best openings to a movie you could possibly get. What do you think of this opening?
I mean, it's basically perfect, isn't it?
It's
a perfect opening because it sums up where we're going in the film.
Yeah.
The idea I've always had is like it's almost like the the people of Lumberton are like hypnotized by the American dream. They're like hypnotized by this kind of perfect facade that that they live in, but it's all fake, you know. They're all ignoring something that's much, much darker. And that's where the idea of repression comes in, that it's there within them all, but it's pushed right down into their bellies, and it's pushed right down underground where the beetles live and the ants. And also the way he like brings to life the idea of a heart attack with the like twist of the hose,
the hose pipe.
Watering hose. Yeah, that it just, it's like perfect filmmaking in my opinion. And then we go back to that at the end as well, which I always think is really interesting, that we kind of return back to some of these images. And, you know, when we kind of return back to it, we see the hypocrisy of it in so many ways, that, you know, they're ignoring this criminal underbelly that they don't want to look at.
Yeah, it's really interesting, isn't it? I know lots of people have different theories about that and the ending, and again, how kind of overly sort of artificial it seems, and you have the kind of robotic robin sort of moving with the bug in its mouth and everything, and people kind of you know, talking about, it was this whole thing a dream in some way, or is this ending a dream, and did it actually end in a much darker way than this film is letting on, etc. Do you have any theories about that, or do you just kind of take it as it is?
No, I always felt like, you know, we enter the ear at the front of the film, we enter the severed ear, and then at the end of the film, we come out of Jeffrey's ear as he's lying sort of sunbathing, and the world is all put back together perfectly. I mean, I think, like I say, there's a real sense of irony there that I don't think Lynch is hiding. You know, the robin is fake. It's eating the beetle that we saw earlier on. There's something tonally that's complete, like, rubbish about this, you know? I think in my... I can't believe I'm going to talk about my dissertation on this, but...
I love it.
In my dissertation, I think I mentioned that, or I sort of decided that Lynch was sort of saying that repression was like an integral part of humanity, that it just exists. And that's what he's reinforcing at the end of the film, that he's kind of saying, well, in order to exist, in order for Jeffrey to sort of exist in this world, he has to push all of that stuff back down. He has to forget that he beat Dorothy, that he killed a man, that he is like Frank in some way, that he's kind of explored this part of himself. He has to go back to being hunky-dory Jeffrey and put all that away in a little box in order to sort of live in that world. And I kind of think that's what that's about.
Yeah, that's so, so good. And I think that perfectly matches, you know, I mean, we're going to be talking about Mulholland Drive later on down the line as well. And I think that thing keeps reoccurring of kind of characters kind of seeing the world as they want to see it, I suppose, and that there's this element of fakeness to it. And again, you know, quite literally Mulholland Drive, I think, maybe putting the nightmares of real life into a box and putting it aside, you know, is, again, something that's really, really interesting in all of his films. What do you think of Carl McLaughlin in this film? Because obviously, you know, he'd previously been in Dune with David Lynch, and then obviously goes on to be Agent Cooper in Twin Peaks. He seems to be almost like a kind of like the embodiment of David Lynch himself or something, right? That's what it seems like to me.
Yeah, that's how I see it as well. It's funny because he's sort of, you know, I talk about when I was a teenager and what attracted me to the film, and I didn't ever, like, Jeffrey's character never, like, struck me in, like, usually you want, like, the protagonist to be the one that you're, like, sort of really hooked on.
Yeah.
And actually in this film, for me, it's always been the other characters, you know, Sandy, Dorothy and Frank. And I think maybe Jeffrey, I love Jeffrey as well. Like I think Carl McLaughlin is like perfectly cast. There's just something a bit mysterious about him. And I think obviously Sandy says to him at one point, I don't know if you're a detective or a pervert.
Yeah.
And he says, that's for me to know and for you to find out. And it's like, it's so, so brilliant, because we don't know if he's a detective or a pervert, but I think there's something so normal about him that we can relate to him and relate to his fascination with the dark side in a way that is comfortable and palatable. And, you know, maybe if he was a bit more rock and roll or a bit more like radical in some way, the story wouldn't allow us into that world with the same kind of naive, like, eyes that we kind of enter through with Jeffries. But at the same time, we've got a little, there's something about him that, you know, is he just a naive teenager who is coming up with crazy ideas because he's seen these things in like a crime TV series? Or is he a bit more sinister?
There are opportunities in life for gaining knowledge and experience. Sometimes it's necessary to take a risk. And I got to thinking, I'll bet someone could learn a lot by getting into that woman's apartment. You know, sneak in, hide, and observe.
Sneak into her apartment?
Yeah.
Are you crazy? Jeffrey, she's possibly involved in murder. This is giving me the creeps.
No, just settle down. I have a plan which I think will work. There's very little for you to do, but I do need your help. Don't you even want to hear the plan?
Well, you can tell me any plan you want, but it's not going any further than this diner.
Sandy, don't take that attitude.
I love that tension throughout as well. And you're right, we never quite know what his deal is. And I guess that's partly adds to the mystery. And also, he is like this blank slate of a person in a way, because I guess he's us. He's, you know, I guess he's all of us. He's this voyeur looking in on this world who is probably is a bit of a pervert and also is a bit curious, but also wants to be a good person. And I guess like all of us in some ways, that's the thing. So, and I expect, yeah. And particularly David Lynch. I mean, clearly David Lynch is somebody who is this, you know, from what we see of him in interviews and behind the scenes footage, he's this very sweet, quite innocent sounding, polite, almost naive guy in a way, which always kind of surprises me. But of course, you know, he is a man who clearly explores his own perverted dark side in his movies. And some of his movies are a bit leery at times, arguably, you know, but then they're also kind of beautiful. And, you know, I've read so many books now on David Lynch, and I've watched so many video essays on David Lynch, and so many people talk about how the ultimate thing that David Lynch is about in his films is balance. That if you look at most of his films, they're usually in some way about finding balance, that you need to have the bad to have the good, you need to have the dark to have the light, and one without the other doesn't work. And in some ways, Blue Velvet is a kind of beautiful, simple version of that, isn't it? Where Jeffrey himself comes from this very quaint, innocent, naive world, and Dorothy comes from this extremely dark, traumatic, terrifying, horrifying, painful world. And the two of them kind of find balance in each other. She kind of finds an element of sweetness in him, and he explores his, you know, slightly darker desires with her. And with each other, they can kind of find that safe balance. But without the balance, you know, you've got one extreme or the other, and it doesn't quite work. I do think that's really interesting. And I think that's all there in Lynch's films, even though he himself is this Jeffrey type character. He's this quite shy looking guy.
I loved the interview with Dennis Hopper when he talks about how David Lynch couldn't say the word fuck on set. And he'd say, when you say that word, and he's like, fuck. And he's like, yeah, when you say that word, because he's so kind of sweet and well-spoken.
So sweet. I love him. I'm obsessed with listening to him talk about things, David Lynch. And he talks, you know, he'll talk so passionately about like painting his, you know, cabinet or building a wall in his house or something, more than he will talk about his own films. But just the way he phrases things, and he's very with his fingers and his eyes closed, and I just love him. I love him. It's wonderful. What do you think the, if anything, the relevance of the song Blue Velvet is to this film. You know, is it just a song that Lynch likes, or is there some reason that it's part of the title and part of this movie?
Well, people say that, I mean, that the blue velvet sash
yes.
is that it represents the umbilical cord. That's what,
no way.
You know, I've read that it's this idea of, you know, Frank returning to the womb in some way. Mm. I mean, we could probably do a whole podcast just on Frank Booth.
We'll get to him.
But I don't know whether or not the idea of that came before the song, or I don't know which came first, but it's such a melancholic, beautiful song for Dorothy to be singing in the club as well. I honestly, I don't know. I mean, the only thing I would connect it to is whether Lynch came up with an umbilical cord or that scenario. Like, he always talks about the idea that his films come to him in fragments.
Yes.
In Catching the Big Fish, he talks about, he's like sat in a room and there's someone in the next room delivering bits of the film to him, and he just has to sit there and receive it. And you wonder what came first with Blue Velvet, and was it the song, was it the blue velvet, you know, dress, was it an image of a woman doing something that he had to kind of figure out? I'd love to, you know, see the film of David Lynch's mind putting this together.
I love that there is a kind of duality to it where, you've got the original Bobby Vinton song, and it is really kind of, I don't know, there's something kind of like cheesy, I suppose, about it. It feels kind of 50s and kind of quaint. And then, like you say, when Dorothy sings it in that club, suddenly there's that kind of sadness to it, and also this kind of sexiness to it, and there's that other side of it that you don't really hear, or at least I don't really hear in the original song.
Absolutely. I always felt that really strongly with In Dreams as well, the Roy Orbison song, and how Frank turns that into something so terrifying and dark when he's saying it into Jeffrey's ear with his hand, you know, like with the lipstick covered around his mouth, and he's going like this with his hand. I mean, I know this is a podcast, but you can show them.
Yeah, with his little hand.
And it's, I just, that to me as a teenager was like thrilling, to spin what is a romantic love song into a threat.
Oh my God.
Basically.
That song now just, it's like the stuff of nightmares to me now, that song,
yeah.
Because of its association. It's incredible.
Get out of there! Get out! Put your hands up on your head! Do it! Get on your knees! Do it! What are you doing? Who are you? What's your name? What's your name?
Jeffrey.
Jeffrey what?
Jeffrey nothing.
Give me your wallet!
Let me ask you then, Prano, about that. Probably the most key, the most iconic scene in the whole film, which is this incredible set piece where Jeffrey sneaks into Dorothy Vallon's apartment. Now, of course, we have this strange moment at the beginning when he hides in her closet and he watches her. It's very voyeuristic. He kind of watches her undress. She takes a phone call. Then, of course, she spots him. And they have this very strange exchange. It's kind of dangerous, but it's also kind of sexy and erotic. And we're not quite sure what's happening. And then Frank Booth arrives and things just get weirder and more terrifying. Frank Booth as this monstrous character, this villain. We're introduced to him here in this kind of almost a sort of sexual assault. It's almost a rape scene, really, that takes place on this living room floor as Jeffrey watches it from his wardrobe. What do you think of this whole sequence?
The whole thing kind of makes me think about like I don't know if this is what Lynch was going for, or if this is just what came from the characters, but it makes me think of like the cycle of abuse in a way when you've watched it and rewatched it, because, you know, Frank has this like ritual set up. Like when he comes in, he says, "Where's my bourbon?" You know, it's what's he say? It's daddy shithead.
Yeah.
And so he's, again, it's like this idea of this umbilical cord, and he talks about coming home and he calls her mummy. And so you start to think about what the hell was Frank Booth's childhood like. But then equally what Dorothy is doing to Jeffrey, you know, she's in control and she repeats some of the things that Frank says to her, you know, "Don't look at me." So you see this kind of the darkness being passed on, maybe. I don't know if that's what it makes me think about anyway.
And it's that, you know, it's that confusing thing of Dorothy kind of enjoying it, or enjoying it with Jeffrey. Like, she wants him to hit her. She wants him to, you know, to treat her in that way that Frank does. And there's that kind of masochism, I suppose, about it as well.
Yeah, I always just felt like she was so sad and broken that maybe the pain kind of takes her closer to death, and that's why she enjoys it so much. I mean, I think at one point Jeffrey says, "I think she wants to die," to Sandy.
Yeah.
And it's like this woman who is just, you know, so broken and destroyed by what the abuse that she's suffering, that it almost is a relief to get closer to death, which is really heartbreaking.
It's really sad. And, you know, that she kind of sees Jeffrey as this strange, like almost mystical figure that just appears in her wardrobe and almost has come to kind of take her away from this world in some way, I think.
Yeah.
And they have obviously a strange relationship, but they actually have some quite sweet moments too that I kind of, I don't know, there's something really sad, obviously, I suppose, about what she's going through and the moments that they have together after they've had sex. And she kind of goes, "Look, I know the difference between right and wrong, and you're my special friend," and all that stuff. And I always find it, there's that weird kind of balance of kind of sordidness, but also quite sweet in their story.
Yeah, he's like a weird hero for her in a way.
Yeah.
But he's also, again, because his intentions are so muddy, and he realizes that himself. I mean, he's setting out sort of with good intentions that he wants to, or is he? I mean, actually, that's never stated clearly, that he's got good intentions in exploring what's going on with this ear. And even the link to him going to Dorothy's apartment is so tenuous. Like, she's just been mentioned by Sandy's dad, and suddenly he's breaking into this woman's apartment. Like, you're kind of going, what is going on for him there? But at the same time, he kind of does end up being her hero in a way, because he kills the bad guy. So it is a very, very complex relationship. And then that is exposed when Dorothy appears in his real life, and exposed in like a really exposing way, because she's completely naked and beaten, and suddenly he's in front of Sandy having to kind of address the way that Dorothy is behaving around him. And, you know, it's like his dark side is being exposed as well as their relationship, I think.
Yeah, exactly. And again, it goes back to that thing I was saying about, you know, they're from these polar opposite worlds, aren't they? She is from this dark, from the shadows. He's from this light, you know, utopian suburbia. And that moment is such a weird moment, because the two worlds kind of clash at that point. Those two sides come together. It's something that's fascinating, you know, in David Lynch's work. Let me just quickly, before we go on to some of that later stuff, I just want to come back briefly to this abuse scene, this sexual assault, this rape, you know, Dennis Hopper coming into the flat, beating Dorothy, sucking on the gas, you know, calling her mummy, making her call him daddy, him kind of humping her. It's such a disturbing and uncomfortable scene to watch. How do you think it's handled? You know, this sort of stuff is hard to get right, I think, sometimes without being exploitative. But how do you think David Lynch handles this scene of sexual abuse?
God, that's a really interesting question, because I think I've known this film for such a long time.
Yeah.
I wonder if I'd see it differently if I saw it for the first time now as an adult, mm-hmm. or in this period of time, because in my mind, it is an abuse scene. I mean, I don't think Frank ever actually, like, he's kind of impotent,
yes.
as a character. Yeah. Anyway, so I don't think he actually has sex with her. It's not that it's not a very horrible, uncomfortable abuse scene. I've always thought about that scene so much about you're so interested and intrigued by the characters going on there that it almost takes me out of seeing it as the real world or seeing it as a real representation.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I suppose everything in Lynch is so hyper real and stylized anyway. It's not like you're watching, you know, Last House on the Left or Straw Dogs or something, is it? That's the thing.
Absolutely. I mean, if I compare it to, I Spit on Your Grave or yeah. Deliverance even, yeah. you know, watching those rape scenes is absolutely horrible. I think I cried watching both of those scenes for the first time. And it really, really, those films ground you in the reality of what that would be like for someone. Whereas this is more like a theatre, even in the sense that Dorothy and Frank are playing characters. They're not, you know, Frank's calling himself daddy and her mummy, and it becomes a show. It becomes like this, and that's why I guess it makes me think more about a cycle of abuse, and I guess why we end up weirdly pitying Frank, you know, as terrifying as he is, he's kind of really pitiful.
Oh, mommy, mommy, mommy,
mommy loves you.
Baby wants to fuck. Get ready to fuck! You fuckers, fucker! You fucker! Don't you fucking look at me!
I know, like, Dennis Hopper talks about how he played the character as someone who's in love. And so there's this kind of weird thing about him. He's like the most terrifying villain, but we see something really sad in him. And I think that scene and the idea of him being daddy and her being mummy,
yeah,
again makes me go back to like what made this person like this. And maybe that's complicated in itself, because should we be empathizing with that, a person doing something like that, you know? That's
yeah.
a whole other conversation to have. But somehow the way David Lynch does it, I think I feel like there's always so much more going on.
What do you think? I mean, because I think it can easily be said that Dennis Hopper is going completely over the top in this role, right? He's Frank Booth is almost a cartoon character villain in some ways. What do you think of the way he is played here by Dennis Hopper and the way Dennis Hopper kind of embodies this character?
Oh, I just love it so much. I mean, I love it. Could not imagine anyone else playing that character. Like,
no.
I mean, I couldn't imagine anyone else being anybody else in this film, but it's incredible. Like, I think one of the things that's really interesting about what David Lynch does in terms of setting up the characters in the worlds is that, you know, when Jeffrey meets Sandy's dad for the first time, and it's really kind of awkward and
yeah.
there's like no subtext going on in that scene. It's like, yes, it's an ear.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jeffrey. yeah. It's all very surface, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think maybe when I've thought about that, and you kind of keep going like, why would he like have a scene like that. It just feels like so clunky and weird.
Yeah.
But then you meet Frank, and Frank is like the opposite of these people. He's like impulsive and aggressive and violent, and he emotes. Like you see him when he watches Dorothy singing Blue Velvet, and he's in love and he's crying, and you know, he's playing this part as somebody who's like desperate to get the love of this woman, but he's got it all completely wrong. I just think that's so exciting. I don't know, but yeah, it's that contrast with the people that we meet earlier in the film. I think that Frank is basically, as his name suggests, he's like the most Frank character in the film. And it's kind of refreshing and exciting, but it's also really, really sad that the only place that characters can like express themselves like that is like the shadows of this universe, that everywhere else there's like a bit of a kind of pretense within the characters. But I think that's what makes him stand out, and I love that he's so over the top. Like, he's hilarious.
the amount of fucks in that, in his dialogue, is absolutely incredible. Yeah.
Don't you fucking look at me! You fucking look at me!
Scarily, didn't he famously say to David Lynch, you know, like, I want to play this character, I was Frank, or something. He was kind of like, I've been to those places. It's like, Jesus.
Yeah, because he'd just come out of rehab when he played it, I think. And yeah, he phoned David Lynch up and said, I am Frank. David Lynch was like, oh, I don't know how I'm going to have lunch with this guy. Oh, God. My cat is called Frank. And he's named after Frank Booth. So I did briefly have another cat who was called Jeffrey, but Jeffrey didn't last very long, sadly.
Oh, Jeffrey.
He was adorable.
Oh.
And Frank was really mean to him. So maybe their namesake.
That is brilliant. I think Frank is terrifying to me. And as much as that whole sequence is really scary, to me, the first time I watched it, the scene that absolutely haunted my nightmares was the joyride sequence where he takes Jeffrey to the brothel and the candy-coloured clown.
A candy-coloured clown they call the Sandman tiptoes to my room every night just to sprinkle stardust and to whisper, go to sleep, everything is all right. I close my eyes.
I hated this scene when I first saw it because I found it so uncomfortable. I don't know why. So you've got Dean Stockwell here, who just looks horrific. He's got that sort of pale makeup on his face. He almost looks like a ghoul. And they're in this clearly very dangerous place with these dangerous people, and you're just waiting for something really violent or nasty to happen. And when they start singing this weird love song, it's just, there's something about it that's just so jarring and nightmarish.
Yeah. I mean, Dean Stockwell, I was a huge Quantum Leap fan I was younger. So I think I'd seen Quantum Leap before watching Blue Velvet for the first time.
Yeah.
And so seeing like Al, but he's like Al, like completely, like he's on opium or something.
Yeah,
and his face, you know, the makeup. I mean, what is it about like those guys, him and Dennis Hopper in this film wearing makeup that's so terrifying? And then you've got these kind of weird extras, just these sort of slightly like rotund middle-aged people with bad hair and big glasses, like just sitting around, you know, like lazy in their like tiny skirts, and it's
so
just
weird.
Such a bizarre kind of beautiful image, like this weird house that just makes you go, okay, who are these people, what the hell is going on here? And then even the decision, I always think of that woman when they're at the car, and he takes him out and he's like saying all this stuff, and there's that lady who just gets up on top of the car and starts like slow dancing. And I think it's just maybe your brain doesn't quite understand it, and so it's scary, even though actually it's not threatening. It's just that you don't completely understand this world, so you don't quite feel comfortable there.
That's it, isn't it? That's exactly it. It's again, it's like David Lynch being a genius and working on a kind of subconscious level of like, what is the most weird and jarring combinations of things you can see? And it's like this beautiful Roy Orbison song, this woman slow dancing, Isabella Rossellini is screaming, Karl McLaughlin's being beaten up and kissed by Dennis Hopper in lipstick, and it's just like, what is going on? It's just one of the most traumatic, jarring moments in cinema. It really, really freaks me out. And what's genius about it, and most of David Lynch's films that freak me out, is that I don't know why it's freaking me out. Like, I don't know why certain images in his films I find so terrifying. But it's really
maybe
creepy.
Maybe it is just that clash of tone, you know? It's like the idea of something being a little bit funny, but at the same time, there's something else going on that's really scary, and it leaves you slightly vulnerable, perhaps.
Hold up tight for me.
So there's a few things I want to touch upon still in this movie that we need to cover. But first of all, we're going to head on over to our Wild About Horror segment. So let's have a little listen to what Freudian cinephile Mary Wilde thinks of David Lynch's Blue Velvet.
Hey, Mike. Mary Wilde here again. So on to another title by David Lynch. This week, the neo-noir mystery Blue Velvet, one of my all-time favorites, a film that initially received a divided critical response, with many stating that its objectionable content served little artistic purpose. However, from a psychoanalytic perspective, I don't regard the violence in it to be unwarranted. It is, as always, an expression of unconscious conflict, which the cinematic medium is particularly well-equipped to process. The discovery of a severed human ear in a field launches an investigation related to a mysterious nightclub singer and a group of criminals who have kidnapped her child. We can see the influence of film noir with tropes such as the femme fatale embodied in Dorothy Valens, the seemingly unstoppable villain Frank Booth, and the questionable moral outlook of the hero Jeffrey Beaumont. Laura Mulvey argues that Blue Velvet establishes a metaphorical Oedipal family among these three characters. Jeffrey, the innocent youth, is disturbed by Frank's violence, but is also tempted by it as a means of possessing Dorothy for himself. She represents the sexual force of the mother figure because she's forbidden and because she becomes the object of infantile impulses. Jeffrey's real father has been hospitalized after a heart attack. Frank is an exaggeration of the obscene power of a punitive father, an archetype that is further developed in the character of Mr. Eddie in Lost Highway. Perhaps the most significant Lynchian trademark here is the unearthing of a dark underbelly in an idealized, wholesome small town. Jeffrey even proclaims that he is seeing something that was always hidden. He sneaks into Dorothy's apartment, hides in her closet, and secretly watches her bizarre sexual encounter with Frank. Sigmund Freud would have called this the primal scene, when the child witnesses an erotic encounter by accident and becomes confused and agitated by what they've seen. The primal scene creates an overwhelming unknown in the psyche of the child, who is not developmentally equipped to process such a moment. One could argue that all of us who have viewed David Lynch films experience a variation of the Freudian primal scene, because he is a director who can conjure up bewilderment and fascination in the spectator by staging scenes at the intersection of sex and violence. Frank Booth inflicts sexual proclivities, inhaling gas, dry humping, sadism, all of these upon Dorothy Valens. He's a foul-mouthed, bad-tempered man whose climax is a fit of both pleasure and rage. He continually refers to Dorothy as mommy and to himself as both the daddy and the baby. Frank has kidnapped Dorothy's husband and son, forcing her to perform sexual favors, urging her to do it for Van Gogh. Van Gogh, the artist, here is code for the severed ear, so certainly an unsubtle threat about the brutal force of corporal punishment. The abuse that Dorothy absorbs in Blue Velvet is rooted in a scene from David Lynch's childhood, something he reveals in the Art Life documentary, an enduring image of a mystery woman he saw as a kid while he was playing in suburban streets. He recalls that one evening, an unknown woman appeared with pale skin, dark hair, and red lipstick, completely naked, out of nowhere, and seemingly injured and crying. Because Lynch, as a young boy, was so small, she appeared like a giant to him, walking by, then sitting down on the curb, sobbing. This was the first time he'd ever seen a woman without her clothes on, and there's certainly an element of the primal scene contained here. Lynch never found out who she was or what had happened to her, but the juxtaposition of eroticism and violence turned into a very compelling image that stirred his imagination. A picture replicated almost exactly in Blue Velvet when Dorothy Valens appears naked out of nowhere in the suburban space in the midst of Jeffrey Beaumont's friends, a loaded symbolic object striking down like lightning onto an ordinary landscape. This is usually the way that unconscious preoccupations manifest. They appear quite unexpectedly and are always staggering. And certainly in Blue Velvet, there is an uncanny juxtaposition of a picture-perfect all-American town pitted against the decaying underbelly of crime, torture, sex, and desire. A tale of opposing forces and entwined dual systems, Eros and Thanatos, existing alongside each other. See you next time.
A big thank you to the wonderful Mary Wilde there. And don't forget, if you want to hear more of Mary Wilde, if you want to check out some of her upcoming courses, book yourself in, I would hugely recommend it. You can follow her at PsychStar on Twitter for all of the details. And also, Mary has her own podcast, Projections Podcast, that she co-hosts with Sarah Cleaver. You can find that in all the usual places you find your podcasts. Another thing I want to ask you about, Prano, is the music. I feel like you can't talk about a David Lynch film without talking about the score, the soundtrack, and in particular, of course, the brilliant Angelo Badalamenti, who, this was the first time they worked together, but obviously they formed such a partnership. Angelo Badalamenti pretty much scored every single thing David Lynch has made ever since Blue Velvet. They seem to just be the perfect pairing. They complement each other so well. Prano, what do you think of the Blue Velvet score?
I think it's, there's something really classic about it, isn't there? There's something just like big and swirling and classic that sort of lifts off, doesn't it? In the same way that the film itself feels like a classic movie, but it's a classic movie with like a mega weird twist, you know, in its DNA, I mean. It's not like anything else. And I think that sort of Angelo Badalamenti's score has a similar kind of feel to it, where it's like grand and beautiful and orchestral, but then there's something else, like there's something weird and twisted and slightly out of tune going on sometimes in the background, you know? It's just unusual.
Yeah, Yeah, agreed. There's that, like you say, that almost at the beginning, you feel like you're watching some sort of Hitchcock film or something. Like you say, classic. It feels classic Hollywood mystery, kind of noir. And then, yeah, the weird sort of distorted sounds and chords and that kind of stuff. I love that. There's that famous video, isn't there, of Angelo Badalamenti talking about working with David Lynch for the Twin Peaks theme. And David Lynch kind of going, there's a girl and she's in the woods and it's beautiful. And he's just kind of playing the chords. And then she's like, now she's sad. And like, I love it. And it feels like those two obviously are just like a match made in heaven, I think. He just kind of creates the sounds that David Lynch kind of dreams up in his mind or something.
Absolutely. I mean, Lynch's music overall is like, I've been obsessed with some of the tracks that he's used.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, Julie Cruz, was it the first collaboration with Julie Cruz as well?
I think it was, yeah.
And The Mysteries of Love, when Dorothy and Sandy go to the dance, and it's like this sort of sweet, innocent, reserved expression of love, again, in contrast to like the Frank Booth, Dorothy world. But I adored that when I was a teenager as well, just watching that scene and that song. And it's the kind of song that I'd just listen to over and over again, just to kind of be in the feeling of it. You know, there's something, he picks such beautifully sad music that you kind of want to like dive into like a pool of that music almost.
Totally. And there's something that's like, I guess it could be quite easy from a cynical point of view to sort of laugh at some of these moments, I think, particularly that moment with Mysteries of Love and those two kind of kissing. He's actually a really kind of earnest filmmaker in a way, isn't he, David Lynch? Like, it doesn't always feel like there's much sort of irony to what he's doing. I think that really was intended to be this like perfect, sweet, romantic moment between those two. But again, it feels kind of old-fashioned in a way, doesn't it?
Yeah. Well, yeah, especially when you've seen Jeffrey. Does he go and have sex with Dorothy before then? I think he does, doesn't he? And he's had this like really sordid, you know, encounter, even though, like we talked about, there's something tender between them. But, you know, particularly when he beats her and things, and it's like these two sides to this person, you know, and that's where the investigation into Jeffrey and maybe into us all, you know, sits in this film, you know, that he can be this kind of squeaky clean guy at the dance with his girlfriend, but then in the shadows, he's doing something quite different.
Do you think this film is supposed to be set in present day at the time it was made as well? Because again, it doesn't feel like predominantly you could say this is an 80s sort of teen movie, but then look at it alongside other 80s teen movies by John Hughes and people like that. Like, it feels like it's set in an entirely different time and place to those movies.
Yeah. There's a 50s vibe for sure with the kind of, I mean, obviously neither of us come from this sort of like American dream world with the white picket fences and the roses. But I think that, you know, there's probably an element of David Lynch's upbringing in there, I imagine, you know, that he's kind of maybe in the same way we're seeing now with like a generation of filmmakers who are all sort of in some ways stuck in the 80s in their heads, me being one of them. Maybe for him, there's an element of that going on there, where he's kind of, there's like this sort of romantic nostalgia for the 50s because of his upbringing, perhaps.
It's very like Twin Peaks too, right? I mean, I feel like this film kind of introduces a lot of the themes that then get fleshed out in Twin Peaks, this idea of a kind of white middle-class Americana that's tinged with this darkness and with these secrets, with this kind of nastier stuff just going on under the surface, you know?
Yeah, and the mystery at the heart of it that kind of isn't really what it's about,
but
keeps you with a thread to hold on to through the story. But it, you know, that's one of the things I love about Lynch, is that, you know, there's always this kind of through line thread, but off that is all these little tentacles that allow you to look at, you know, other ideas, things about, you know, what human instinct and darker aspects, but you need something to carry you through the story, and there's that mystery. And in this, it's the ear and Dorothy and obviously in Twin Peaks, it's who killed Laura Palmer.
Oh, I know. We've touched upon it already briefly, but let me just ask you about Laura Dern as well. I mean, what a hero Laura Dern is. And she looks so young here, doesn't she? What do you think of her and her sort of performance in this film?
Well, she was 18, wasn't she, I think, when she made this. She's kind of, yeah, I mean, I know that I just describe everything in this film as like, oh, it's perfect. It's perfect. But, you know, again, she's sort of dreamy, and her speech about the Robins and this, again, like this kind of naive romanticizing of like this perfect world. And, you know, she's like a beacon of hope and light for Jeffrey through the film. And similarly to Jeffrey, she's not like remarkable in the same way that like Dorothy and Frank are, that, you know, but she, I don't know, she just encapsulates something really kind of stunning and dreamy in this film. I love her. And yeah, probably she's one of the first characters I fell in love with in it.
Amazing. I love her. She's got such an expressive face and mouth, especially when she cries. She's just got such a brilliant face, Laura Dern. I love her.
Yeah, and the scenes where they go for milkshakes and...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just... there's something really kind of adorable and cute about these two very strange young people, because she's also got that intrigue in the dark side as well, you know, and there's something dangerous about her, even though she's squeaky clean on the outside. Like, she says she loves Mike at one point. You know, let's set the record straight. I love Mike, she says to Jeffrey. And yet she's sneaking off and lying to her parents. And, you know, she's seeking a thrill as well in this, I think. But maybe not to the same extent as Jeffrey. I think she'd draw the line earlier.
She would draw the line, exactly. I think the way that those two couples kind of mirror each other, I mean, I'm sure this has been talked about by thousands of academics, but this idea of like Dorothy and Frank almost being like this kind of id version of Sandy and Jeffrey in a way, aren't they? They're kind of like, there's the kind of squeaky, clean, sunny couple, and then the kind of the couple that are kind of in the darkness behind the curtains kind of thing.
Yeah. And I guess it's like a little bit of... each of them exists in the other, you know.
Yeah.
Was Dorothy once Sandy? And what elements of Dorothy exist in Sandy? I think there's something so neat about that and about the setup of this film. And that's what like keeps me coming back to it again and again, because it's so simple, but it's so well crafted and so well put together.
Yeah, agreed. So let me ask you about this weird, bonkers final act where Jeffrey kind of goes back to Dorothy's apartment. This is kind of when it's all kicking off and Frank is following him there. And he finds those two dead bodies that are kind of like upright dead bodies, aren't they? I mean, again, I suppose there doesn't have to be a reason for it, but what do you make of that scene and what's happening here?
It's really interesting that you ask that, because it's so weird and yet I never really needed to know. Like, it's like the plot, this film could have been you know, the crime thriller of like Frank Booth and, you know, what he does to his cronies and how all these people end up, you know, dying. But actually we don't really need to know any of that, or at least I have never really needed to know any of that. Like, I'm so sucked into Jeffrey and Dorothy and Sandy's stories that this like image in the background when we're in that flat and you've got like what is actually quite a beautiful kind of painterly image of a guy with like a head wound standing up, and at one point his arm like flicks out and he knocks something over, and you're like, well, is that a reflex, like post-death reflex, or is he still alive? And then you've got this guy chained to a radiator with like something stuffed in his mouth and his hands tied up, and it's kind of dark and beautiful all at the same time, and it tells a story that really is violent and bizarre and weird. But at the same time, I've watched this film over and over and over again, and I don't really need to know what happened.
It's true.
You know,
Every single time I watch this film, and I've seen it so many times as well, I always forget that there's this whole thing about the well-dressed man and the man in yellow and all that stuff, because it really feels like that's not really what this film is. But of course, there is this crime mystery going on the surface. But it's much less about that. And you're right, it's just this kind of dark but beautiful, weird sort of tableau, that moment. I love it. It's really weird,
and the colors are just I mean, Dorothy's apartment in itself, like, the colors are just delicious. And then you've got his yellow coat, and it, you know, it's like such a gruesome image, but it's so gorgeous and weird.
Yeah, it really is. It really feels to me almost like, again, we've mentioned it, but there's something about it that feels like an old school mystery that's coming to an end here, like a Hitchcockian final act, like something we would see in Rear Window or something, that misdirection. He lures the bad guy in with the walkie-talkie, and then he evades him, and then there's that gunshot as he shoots him, and everything returns to normality. Equilibrium appears to be restored at that point. So finally then we have that dreamy, weird ending, you know, that Mysteries of Love, that Julie Cruise music comes back in. We're back in bright, sunny suburbia. Everyone is back. They're all looking happy. There's a robin. You know, everything seems to have been tied up in a bow so neatly, almost too neatly, don't you think? Like, this is very different to any other David Lynch film in the way that everything is resolved.
But I think that's part of... you know, you've got like the final sort of shot of the film of Dorothy reunited with her son.
Oh, I love that moment.
And
and
it's like it's all perfect and everything's fine now, but you know that underneath all of that there's like still this absolute sadness in this character. How does somebody and a child overcome that? Like, he's kind of pitching it really well in terms of like, oh yeah, everything's back to normal and it's all fine now, but it's like, really? How, you know, she's gonna need years of therapy. Nobody would recover from something like that. And the bad guys in this story have gone, but what, we're restored back to the earlier normal world of Lumberton, and actually we know that there's dark stuff going on underneath, and I'm sure that that's not the end of the dark stuff. It's just now we choose to ignore it again.
And I still can see blue velvet through my tears.
That final image is so subtle and so perfect, that when she hugs her son and she's smiling, and then there's just that tiny little like morsel of a look of sort of sadness and fear in Isabella Rossellini's face as that kind of like blue velvet music kicks back in again. It's just so good.
Yeah, it really is.
Really, really powerful. So, I mean, obviously, I don't really have to ask you this, but I was going to say, you know, what I usually finish with is sort of saying, you know, like, would you recommend this film to people still? And, you know, how do you think it's aged, you know, 35 years on?
Yeah, I mean, yes, I would always recommend this film to everybody, because it's one of my favourite films. And I would recommend not just seeing it once, but seeing it over and over and over again, like me. I watched it actually a couple of years ago at the Prince Charles Cinema. It was, and I don't think I'd ever seen it in the cinema before, because when I was growing up, I lived in the middle of nowhere in Wales. We didn't have a cinema nearby, so everything was VHS for me then. But it was really weird and interesting seeing it with an audience, because people were laughing in places that, like, people laughed when Dorothy appears naked on Jeffrey's doorstep, and I felt like offended that, you know, it made me think about how either how it's aged and also how people interpret it if you don't know Lynch's other work as well.
Definitely.
But I did think, you know, there are the humor definitely kind of, you know, there was a lot of laughs in the audience, and laughs at things that I wouldn't normally expect, but also the kind of clunkiness, like we've talked about the clunkiness of some of the scenes. It felt like seeing it in that environment with other people, I felt like it aged differently to how I feel it's aged when I watch it on my own, if that makes sense.
Totally. It's something about Lynch, I think. It almost feels like a kind of personal experience. Like you, in some ways, I don't like watching some of his films with audiences, because everyone has such their own kind of unique experience and relationship with each one of his films, you know?
Yeah, totally.
And again, it goes back to that earnestness. I think it is a very earnest film, and I think I can imagine it is easy for people to laugh at moments of it. But
it may be that people... Because sometimes people laugh when they feel uncomfortable, and so there may be an element of that going on. I mean, the first time I ever saw The Exorcist, and like she wheezes on the floor, I mean, I was really little, but that I thought that was so funny.
Yeah.
And actually it's so much that's really disturbing in that, but I was like, my response was to laugh, and sometimes people do laugh. And I guess the way he plays with tone can make that feel complicated for some audiences, and maybe particularly audiences now who want, I don't know, sort of tone to be quite like defined and clear. I personally love films that play with tone in an interesting way. I saw Horse Girl recently, and I thought that played with tone and I looked at the reviews online, and they were quite middling, and I thought, oh, maybe that's because, you know, it doesn't quite land in the like quirky comedy, and it also doesn't quite land in this sort of weird psychological sci-fi-esque thing. But for me, I love that combination, whereas some people go like, oh, I want it to be this one thing that I can get off the shelf. And Lynch, you know, Lynch definitely muddles that in a way that you either get it or you don't get it, I think.
I think it's very easy to and I found with most of his films, maybe not Blue Velvet actually, but some of his others are frustrating in some ways, and especially on first watch. And I think with all of his films, you need to watch them two or three times. And even with Twin Peaks The Return, did you watch the new sort of Twin Peaks series?
I haven't finished it. I've watched about half, and I do need, like, I need to get back to it. But
you've got to get on it.
Yeah.
But it is, again, there's something, it's fascinating and it's brilliant, but also there's something very frustrating about it, because he always subverts your expectation. It's like, oh, great, we're going back to Twin Peaks, and he doesn't give you any of the stuff that you want or that you expect to see, or he makes you wait for it, you know, and it's really interesting. Just briefly, let me ask you before we finish, what are your thoughts on the rest of Lynch's career? Do you have any other favourites post Blue Velvet, any that you're not a big fan of?
So I love Mulholland Drive. I think I saw that twice in the cinema, like I was going back and watching it on my own, and yeah, I haven't seen that for years. I need to rewatch that film.
Oh, it's so good.
I only ever saw Inland Empire once.
Me too.
At the cinema, and I didn't click with it. I think obviously he shot most of his work on film, and that's the first time he was working digitally. So perhaps there was something about the aesthetic that didn't grab me. I would like to return to that as well and give it a second chance, because at the time I think I was a little bit hurt that I don't.
Me too. I've only seen it the once as well, and I was also a little bit hurt. And I'm really excited. I am going to revisit it, obviously, for this podcast, and I'm really intrigued to watch it again. I think now knowing what I'm in for, maybe, because I think expectations help, don't they, with this
that's
kind of thing.
That's it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's it. I'm such a massive Lynch fan that like to not like one of his films is is like painful. So I definitely think I should return to that one for sure.
Awesome. Prano, thank you so much for joining me to talk about this film. It's been so much fun. Where can people find you sort of out there on social media and that kind of thing if they want to come and chat to you?
I am on Twitter as Prano Bailey-Bond, and I have a website which is www.pranobaileybond.com.
Lovely. And anything you can tell us about any upcoming projects being released yet? Or I suppose it's a bit unknown at the moment, is it?
Right now, since we are just waiting to kind of be able to get back on and finish work. And then I guess we're all trying to work out right now what the landscape of film festivals and distribution is going to look like. So it's going to be an interesting journey, but hopefully not too long.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And that's it for this week. Thank you so much for listening, and a huge thank you to my brilliant guest, Prano Bailey-Bond. So please do get in touch. What did you think of this week's episode, and what do you think of David Lynch's Blue Velvet? Do you love it as much as me and Prano do? Where does it rank in Lynch's career for you? Please do get in touch. The email address is evolutionofhorror@gmail.com. You can also find us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Letterboxd. And if you want to discuss this week's film and anything else horror related with fellow listeners, then you can simply join the Evolution of Horror discussion group, and you can find that on Facebook. If you want to support this podcast and everything we do here to make the Evolution of Horror, then you can sign up to our Patreon. If you're able to donate $5 per month, you will be treated to regular bonus content. This week we concluded our countdown of the top 50 scariest ever moments in horror, as voted for by the patrons. It's an amazing list. Some incredible moments. You'll really enjoy listening to that episode. That is available for the price of $5 per month. And if you're able to donate $10 per month, you'll also get access to our exclusive mini-seasons. And next week, we'll be bringing you the next part of our Twin Peaks mini-series, speaking of Lynch, in which Anna Bulgatskaya and I will be discussing Fire Walk With Me. So if you want to sign up for all of this content and more, head on over to patreon.com/evolutionofhorror. That's patreon.com/evolutionofhorror. You can find this podcast on all major podcast platforms, including iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, Acast, Libsyn, and Spotify. Please drop us a little rating or review if you get a chance. It really helps us get discovered by new listeners. Okay, so on to next week then. And we are just spoiling you week after week with absolute masterpieces. Next week, we're swinging back from Lynch to Cronenberg, and things are going to get nasty. Next week, I'm going to be joined by the co-hosts of the Journey Through Sci-Fi podcast, James and Matt, and we are going to be discussing David Cronenberg's 1986 masterpiece, The Fly. Join us next week for all of this and more on the Evolution of Horror.